Make sure everyone can hear me all right. Hey, so just to chat a little bit more about what the Train 2.0 webinars are, just so you know, I'll just start by saying this, that they're going to be going on every day at noon or 5 p.m. And we're going to be covering a different part of the dominant player system. And the previews, or these, the full webinars, will remain on YouTube for up to about a week. And then the full-length ones will be deleted, and they will be stored in the membership area. So if this is your first time to the webinar, or first time coming across this, or Train 2.0, I'd like to say hi. My name is Jason Yee, and I'm a trained kinesiologist. I am a former college hockey player. I'm the CEO and founder of Train 2.0, the creator of the dominant player system, and I've trained and coached thousands of players. And it is time to upgrade. So in today's video, and I'm just going to check back on the and see how we're doing. Okay, so yes, every day at noon or 5 p.m. Pacific, well, most days I'm going to do my absolute best to be on at noon or 5 p.m. Pacific, and I'm going to be outlining a different part of the dominant player system. If I'm not on, I'm sorry, but every day, Monday to Friday is my goal. And just so you know as well, if you're a Train 2.0 member, I go live with you, not publicly, but live on Tuesdays at 5 p.m. and I talk to members face-to-face using Google Hangouts. So today's plan is to say hi, and that's already done. We're going to go over the plan, and that's where we are here. And we're going to review the dominant player system. And then we're going to go over today's lesson, which is playing probabilistically, and I'm going to answer any questions that you guys have. And then I also have a few submitted to me already. And then you sign up for Argo or a Train 2.0 membership, and I'll explain what those are at the end. So my promise to you is that I know there's lots of things you could be doing with your time, so I appreciate that you've given me this opportunity to have your time, and I take that seriously, and I promise to make it worth your time. Now, the dominant player system comes from my career, my education, and my profession as a coach. And it came from really my own hockey career, which was where my efforts didn't equal the results I thought I should be getting. And I also found that the common advice that I was getting from coaches was simply not effective. So my goal with the dominant player system is to design a better system for committed players to follow. So here it is, the grand unveiling. I've had this in my head, and I've used various forms of measuring it for years, but this is my first time codifying it in a visual manner. So I was I've been happy to roll this out. I worked on this over the weekend, and here it is. So to explain it, you want to think of it as a pyramid, and the base of the pyramid, or the widest parts of the pyramid, are the parts that I believe are going to make the biggest difference. So if you're looking to 80-20 your progress, you want to start at the base and fill those out. Naturally, if you imagine that each part of this could be filled up, the parts that are biggest, the parts at the bottom, at the base of the pyramid, are going to give you the most bang for your buck, the most value. So you can see different parts of these on my website, in my blogs, in my YouTube videos. The Bulletproof Mindset and the Accelerated Learning Framework take up the bottom part. And the bulletproof mindset is required just very simply to be able to handle the rigors and the inadvertent or unavoidable failures that are going to come your way. And we're going to talk about how failure is unavoidable and what to do about that. And then the accelerated learning framework, which is the science of learning at an accelerated rate, is also required along with the bulletproof mindset to accelerate your results. If you're simply not, if you don't have your bulletproof mindset or the accelerated learning framework, then you are going to be struggling. You guys are going to be on a narrow base. The next level is the puppeteer framework. I call it the puppet versus the puppeteer framework. And it's the idea of being in control of the game, being able to manipulate other players with deception, with skill, with reading angles and understanding that. The next ones are upgraded formulas, which is blending skills together in a formula to create on-ice success. And I believe that part and parcel to that is upgraded skills. So the ability to execute your skills efficiently. And I think they work together because your ability to use upgraded formulas is dependent on your skills and vice versa. Then I see off-ice habits and skills. So strength, conditioning, speed, your rest and recovery habits, your stretching as being the next level, and then the last one I see is nutrition. Now, I'm not saying nutrition is not important. I'm not saying off-ice skills and habits aren't important. What I'm saying is their ability to have impact on your game is smaller than the things on the base level or the lower levels. Now, I call this the dominant player system because I believe this is the system that dominant players have because I have seen some very, very good players fueling themselves with McDonald's before games and still performing very well because they had the bottom rungs taken care of. Now, like I said, it's not an excuse for poor nutrition, but I'm just giving you an idea of the scope of what can impact your game. Now, the typical coaching system, this is what a lot of coaches, the hockey zeitgeist, would typically preach. They'd say things like, you must work on your skills. And I say typical skills because most people don't have an idea of how to teach skills properly, or they're teaching the wrong skills. Then there's a huge focus on off-ice skills and habits. That's why this is completely filled up. So strength and conditioning, stretching, all sorts of off-ice things are really highly prioritized. And then nutrition, I find, is also prioritized. And as you can see with the dominant player system, I think the scope, the impact that these things can actually have on your game is quite low, at least relative to the lower things. So what you see is, at the bottom level, you see this quote-unquote mental toughness, where coaches do their best to teach mental toughness or extol the virtues of mental toughness, but don't know how to go about doing that. Then I see learning, not accelerated learning, but just learning. And the reason these are different colors is because they're qualitatively looking at these things in a different way than the dominant player system. So learning is just the idea that maybe you can get better at things, but not taking an accelerated learning framework approach, not using the science of motor learning and the psychology of being in a flow state to engineer the fastest progress. The puppeteer framework is hardly understood, barely understood, and definitely not taught, except by very, very few and probably no less than, two people in the world or no more. Whatever, you get the idea. Let's say there's five people in the world. I don't know who they are, but I know two. And then formulas, again, that's kind of similar to the puppeteer framework. People don't often know what those are. They just think of blending skills together. And they don't really think about it in this way. And then, like I said, typical skills, they're often teaching skills that are less effective than the upgraded skills. And there's a huge, huge, huge focus on that. And then kind of your instructions for the dominant player system is aim to fill the entire pyramid and prioritize the base and move up. The instructions for the typical coaching system are usually work harder. And that doesn't quite cut it for the dominant players or the players who are dominant. And you know, if people are curious, I'm going to pause for questions here, but if people are curious about what my own pyramid looked like when I was younger, actually, I'll just show you because I have it on Excel here, but I'll check back for questions. And here I am. Hopefully people like my Christmas lights behind me. I'm going to check back for questions if there's any. Not right now. Ben, you're letting me down here. There should be at least 7 questions. anyway, you guys, I'm going to show you guys my screen. I'm going to show you guys a little bit what I think my own pyramid looked like. Give me one sec. So this is kind of like the evolution of me, I think. Again, this is very subjective. I have more objective measures, but I obviously couldn't use them to create this hypothetical. But if you were to look at me in 2008, this was me going into my first year of junior hockey, out of midget hockey, you would see the nutrition, off-ice habits, and skills would be very, very high. I had those dialed, and I had optimized them. But as you guys can see, optimizing these things didn't lead to a full picture or a full pyramid, a solid base. One of the biggest things was the puppet versus puppeteer framework. That was quite weak, and that took a lot of work to improve. The other thing would be the formulas that I was using, and I wouldn't say I was using the most effective learning strategies. And of course, my skills still needed improvement. Then hit 2010. This would be my first year heading into at UBC. And my nutrition and off-ice habits got even better. But again, I'm optimizing something that has a low impact on... I'm hoping that everyone can see my screen. I just want to make sure of that. Yes, okay. this is my own evolution here. So that made that adjustment. And then heading into my last year at UBC, this is kind of more where I was at. And again, I optimized more of my movement. But what started to occur was... the upgraded formulas were getting a little more figured out. I really kicked up my accelerated learning framework, and then the puppeteer framework was the one that made the biggest change. I really made a really large change with the puppeteer framework. And then what happened in... This is my hypothetical where I'm at now. And now I'm not playing competitively, but I would say that my knowledge of these things is a little more filled out, and you know, there's still definitely some work to do, but I just wanted to give you an idea of how this might look, and so you can think about this in your own game. And of course, we'll be reviewing this every webinar, free training that we're doing. And what will be happening is we'll be fleshing out each part of this. So you will know exactly what the Bulletproof Mindset is, Accelerated Learning Framework, blah, blah, blah. So we'll be doing this every day, and this will be kept in the membership area. Well, the full videos will be, the previews will be, remain here. So now we're going to, I'm going to check back for questions. Bathroom break. Is that why the pyramid, most important skills on the bottom? Yes. So, the question is, I see that these as the most important, and you know, they give you the most opportunity for improvement. So you know, think of this as impact on your game, right? So like the width of it is the impact of your game, on your ability to be a dominant hockey player. So as you go up, your ability to impact your dominant player status is lessening as you go up towards nutrition. Again, nutrition is still important, but less so than others. Accelerated framework. So the accelerated learning framework is, I have it on my website, actually. I think if you go into about, you can look at the accelerated learning framework. And it is just basically the science of learning as fast as possible. And there are a number of validated methods to learn as fast as possible. And it's simply applying them. And I'll tell you the story of, I don't know if I need to tell you a story, but it's, there's a psychology, there's mechanics, and there's the science of motor learning. All these things factor together towards the accelerated learning framework. And it's just a way to really take your improvement to the next level. And I call I say train 2.0 is about getting better faster, because I think it's Alice in Wonderland, I never watched those ones, Alice in Wonderland and Through the Looking Glass and those, like, those classics. Anyway, I'm digressing here, but I think as a Red Queen and some sort of thing, the quote that stood out to me was, "We're all running as fast as we can to stay in the same place." Well, of course, that's the truth. Everyone is trying to get better. That's how you get to the next level, is by getting better. So the person who gets better the fastest is going to beat out their competition. No matter where you are, your focus must be on your rate of improvement, not just where you are right now. So that's why I think the accelerated learning framework is absolutely critical. I'll check back for another question. Proteins again. All right. So we're going to go into the upgraded formula, and today we're going to talk about, I'll just quickly review this. So the idea is to explain 80% of the effect of something that's happening in hockey. My goal is to make the formula clear and specific, visual, actionable, and use it as a way to instruct. So today's lesson, we're going to talk about probabilistic playing, thinking about failure, and Mitch Marner's flow, which was a request from last week. And it's something that kind of looks like magic, and I'm still trying to figure it out myself. And so maybe the questions that come up will help me think about it more clearly. So, playing with probabilities. So, a lot of people have a hard time thinking probabilistically because it's not a challenge for our brains to actually think in this way. So, here's the deal, is that anything you're doing has a probability of success and a probability of failure. So we understand, if you flip a coin, there's a 50% chance of heads and there's a 50% chance of failure. People don't really understand how the bell curve works, though, which is that that the more something occurs, the more likely it's going to tend towards a probabilistic outcome. I'm using too many big words. I should probably stop that, but basically, over time and with large numbers, you're going to get a predictable response. And so the thing that we're going to look at practically here in hockey is goal scoring. Now, this happens with absolutely everything, but let's just break this down. If we talk about probabilistic goal scoring, if you take 10 shot attempts in a game, 2 are likely going to get blocked, so 8 will get directed to the net. Probably 6 of them will end up on net, or maybe 5. And then 0.6 of those will end up as goals, right? So salespeople have funnels where they know that, a certain number of people are going to be leads, meaning they're going to touch base with them. Then they become, I don't know the exact terminology, but then they become prospects, meaning they've touched base and the person seems interested, and then they close them. And what ends up happening is you have, a large number of people who are, leads, or maybe I'm messing this up. I don't know my sales terminology, but you have a large number that's leads. Let's say that's 100%. Then you have a smaller number that's your prospects. I think I'm mixing it up, but anyway, that is, let's say it's 80%, and then customers becomes, you know, 40%. As you go down the quote-unquote funnel, the number gets smaller, and it's based on probabilities. And this is the exact same for goal scoring. Now, here's the thing, is a lot of players see failure as proof or, you know, deterministic that they cannot score goals. So if on the first two shots they get a blocked shot, they will stop shooting because they think it means they don't know how to shoot. But probabilistically, their next two attempts are probably going to make it to the net. So that's why I say to expect failure and crave it, because failure signals activity. The player who believes that a lack of goal scoring or a lack of success means that they are not a successful player will simply take zero attempts on goal, and as a result, they get zero goals, right? Zero attempts on net means zero directed at the net, zero shots on net, so zero goals. So a player who understands that there is a probability of failure and a probability of success understands that the more they execute that skill, be it, you know, playing in a game, making a pass, trying to hit someone, you know, shooting, the more they understand that failure doesn't mean they are a failure. Failure means they are doing something. And then once they observe the probabilities, then they can just simply adjust. And so we see this with a big one is Ryan Kessler's season. Ryan Kessler is typically a 25 goal a year season, or a 25 goal a year player. But in 2010-2011, he scored 45 goals. If you look at one of the biggest differences, it is really simply, yes, his conversion went up from about 15% to 20% that season. So he was shooting better, but he was also shooting more. He took twice as many shots that season. And if we actually maybe go look that up. So we can see Ryan Kessler. My website, I saw that one there, is train2.0.com. If we look at Mr. Kessler's stats, they're not very good stats. Where was the other one I was seeing? Here we are. So this is shooting shots. Where are they? These ones? No. Shorthand goals. This is a shooting percentage. These are shots. All right. What do you notice about the difference between this year where he had 41 and this year where he had 25, or this year where he had 22? Is a difference of about 40 shots. All right. So he's shooting just a lot more. And then you see the same thing the rest of his career is he's just shooting less, right? Maybe his conversion is higher, like in this case it's higher, but he's just shooting more. Now, who knows which direction that relationship goes, but it's important for people to think probabilistically about hockey. So I'm going to check back on the questions that we have here. How the hell he does it, damn it. Gene, yeah, you got to take over the questioning. Shouldn't you be watching a hockey game right now? Okay. So what I wanted to go over next, if there's any questions, was this thing. And I don't know what to call it yet, but I just want to show it to people. Because I saw it and I went, oh, that's interesting. So watch this play. Mitch Marner comes in here. Ooh, that is different, isn't it? And what happens here, kind of looks like magic, And in looking at it, I'm thinking this is something very new. This is something very different. And what's happening is, if anyone's seen my Crosby puck protection guide, we're seeing this. That is a very Crosby-like maneuver, which is getting getting the hips between the puck and the other player. Okay, that is a very Crosby-esque thing. Well, I mean, it's an everyone thing, but Crosby does it the best. And the other thing that Marner does well here is he plants his front foot, okay? And he's pushing off his heel. Now, the interesting thing is, as he receives this contact, he uses it to just keep sliding. I was quite amazed at this play. So what he's doing is, rather than trying to fight him, he's rolling with him. And he literally uses the momentum, the push of this player, to shift his weight. And watch here, as he gets that push, and he's actually trying to puck protect, but he lets the push happen, and he just simply slides off of him and ends up with complete separation from this defenseman. Right, look how far away he got. So this is an innovation. I see it. I'd like to say I've seen this a whole bunch of times before, but it stood out to me as a different type of play. So, that's what I had to show there. I'm going to check back in on the questions and see if there's any there. Yeah. So he push off him, it looked like, the opposing player. Yeah, very, like, it's just like, and now the push off is very common, or, you know, having the I think you know, Belfry and Stride Envy, they call it the chuck, but I haven't necessarily seen this iteration, or, and maybe I'm wrong, and maybe I think, of course, Marner is a Belfry product, since Belfry is a Toronto Maple Leafs player development guy, so maybe this is a new innovation on his part. But I am extremely impressed with this maneuver. I actually think it's incredible that he uses the momentum, the push, to really simply just power himself through. Yeah, you're right. Tarasenko does do something similar, and I will have to find more. Tarasenko is—he's one of, I mean, obviously with his scoring, he's one of the elite, and he does some amazing things. And I see it as him as quite a natural, one of the guys with the biggest toolkits. So if there's any other questions, I'm happy to go over those. Otherwise, I'm going to close out today. Gene, any questions? Okay, I'm not seeing anything there, so I'm going to continue. Oh, and I'm just going to go back all the way to the start, which is that I want to remind people that every day, or Monday to Friday, noon or 5 p.m., I'll decide on the day, depending on what time I get up, you know, from my partying the night before. I'm just kidding. But I'll decide on the day whether I'll be doing it at 9 or 5 p.m., usually whether it meshes with my schedule. So expect anything. Expect the unexpected. What I'm going to do is, these full-length videos will remain on YouTube for about a week. Then they will be taken down, and previews will be left in their place. The full-length ones end up in the membership area, the Train 2.0 membership, which is just train2.0.com/membership, and you'll have full access to those there. So what I'd like to do now is I want to introduce you to Argo, which is a text message bot. It's a virtual coach bot. And if you're interested in becoming a dominant player, it is the only intelligent virtual coach in the world for hockey. It is customized to you. It learns your preferences. And it'll give you the exact training and logic I use with players to become a dominant player. So It is very simple. It's just a number. You text it, and it is kind of like AI. Or maybe it's too good, not good enough yet. But this is, I think, the only intelligent virtual coach for hockey in the world. We'll see if that's the case or not. Maybe someone can correct me. Oh, Riley, we got a good question here. Is there a good way to penalty kill? I'll dive on that one and then go back. Riley, though, what do you mean by is there a good way to penalty kill? Like, do you mean as a player? Do you mean as a coach? What do you mean by that? I'll hang out and wait. I'll check back, Riley. But yeah, so to check out Argo, I'll give you the number on the next little bit. And then the other thing is that, like I said, you can access all of these daily webinars, the archives, plus all of my online camps. And you'll be able to access live training every week with me, where you'll be able to call in and actually have a talk with me and other members, where I'll answer all your questions live. You don't have to do it through the chat box. Plus, you'll get access to my NHL clip library. So all the clips that I'm using and storing for the upgraded formulas and for the dominant player system, I have that in a folder that you as a member have complete access to. And you'll get access to the dominant player checklist, which is a comprehensive checklist to make sure that you are on track to become a dominant player. Let's check back to Riley. Like, as a player, there are good strategies or tips you can give. Okay. Yeah. There are. So I'll answer your question there quickly. What I'm going to do is I'll just look up a Kane video where Kane ends up scoring on the power play, but I know it's on the power play. Kane. It's this one. No, not the one. Can this one, this one. One of these. Think it's this one here. So, just because I know this one is a PK one. No, actually, Riley, are you defenseman or forward? The things to remember on a penalty kill are generally move in straight lines and keep your stick in the lane that is going to reduce the highest risk pass. Now, I'm sounding really complicated here, but it's pretty simple. I'll try and show you what I mean by that. Is that this defenseman, if we were to use him as an example, the highest risk pass that Kane could probably make would be something across here. So this defenseman has his stick in this lane. Okay, the other thing is, so as it goes down, again, all three of these players, now they get picked apart in a second by Kane. But all three of these players are respecting that rule. Their stick is in the lane that leads to the most dangerous pass, right? This is the most dangerous pass, probably, and all three of these guys are respecting that. And the reason you want to do that is obviously so that the stick is there if the puck is there. The other reason is because it's like an actual visual cue. Oh, this one. It's an actual visual cue to say, no, this area is it's too busy, right? I'm not even going to look there because a stick is already in the way. The other thing to notice, like I said, is move in straight lines. So watch how, I think this is Ladd comes up, stops, start, back in a straight line. right? And then again, we can watch this player, and they're all getting mixed up here, but they go straight line, stop, stop, straight line, stop, right? So these are kind of like the two of the most basic habits is the stick in the lane and then skating in a straight line and stopping. I hope that answers your question. I'll check again though, Riley. Forward. Yeah, I mean, I think those two are the most basic, and those are the most and they'll kind of give you the biggest bang for the buck. So yeah, I hope that answers your question, and tune on tomorrow. I'll be live around probably noon tomorrow, so or shortly after, so tune on if you like. Now back to the Train 2.0 membership. Like I said, you'll have access to all my online camps, and I have tons. How to Skate Like Jack Eichel, How to Drive Wide Like Connor McDavid, the full camp, explosive skating speed, injury proofing your hips, mental state training, some of the NHL code that I call it, their secrets for success. And then you also, like I said, have access to the archive of the webinars, live training with me every week, and the NHL clip library and dominant player system. So that's all included in the Train 2.0 membership. And as I have a pretty good deal, which is pay what you want and cancel anytime. And you will basically, you have access now, and get to it before I come to my senses and make you guys pay a normal rate, which is, you know, a lot of money for it. So basically you need a credit card because I need to make sure that you are 18 or have approval of someone who's 18. And then whatever you value my material at, or value access to the stuff at, I appreciate everything. And 10% of what I make, or what Train 2.0 makes, goes towards kids sports so that all kids can play. So that's really important to me. So what you can do is you can go to www.train2.0.com/membership, or if you want to text Argo, like I mentioned, just simply text it and say Argo. You have to say the word Argo to start it. And these are the two numbers, 778-400-1627, or if you're in the US, it's 415-969-3533. You text it, say Argo, you can start chatting with your virtual coach named Argo right away. You can start training. You can ask it for food. You can ask it for mental coaching to help you get in the zone. Basically, whatever you want. So that is the webinar for today. Join me tomorrow, probably at noon, and I look forward to seeing you. Thank you guys for watching.